Good morning. I am Dr. Jeffrey Allen Murdoch. I am the Director of Choral Activities here at the University of Arkansas and the founding director of the newly established Arkansas Center for Black Music. This is our second lecture of our first day of lecture series in the Arkansas Black Music Symposium, and it is my privilege to introduce our next lecturer. Before I do so, I want to encourage you to visit Glendower Jones and Classical Vocal Reprints out in the North Lobby. If you are live streaming, feel free to interact with us in the chat and share anything that you find interesting or any questions that you might have in the chat. Without further ado, I would like to introduce you to our next lecturer, a dear friend of mine and a scholar and a professor at the University of Cambridge. We brought her all the way across the pond to talk to us today, Dr. Alicia Lola Jones.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. What a treat it is to be invited to share research by a friend, Dr. Murdoch. Thank you so much for your kind invitation. I'm so happy to be able to see folks and share this work in progress. My husband and I trekked here eagerly trying to be a part of history, Calvin Taylor Skinner and I. So, let us begin. And I would like to preface our time together by just sharing that this particular presentation will deal with both the pleasure and pain of gastromusicology that I think African-American histories afford us. The shelter-in-place order of the pandemic was a blessing to artists who saw the marketplace open in energizing ways. Simultaneously to fans' delight, soul music singer Gladys Knight and R&B artist Patti LaBelle agreed to engage a social media phenomenon called Verzuz, bringing to the Instagram platform music that has been the soundtrack of our lives. As seasoned touring tastemakers, Knight and LaBelle exemplify a gastromusical physics in their business ventures, expertise producing food that makes people want to sing. Verzuz is an American webcast series of musical duels, ideally between peer performers, created by producers Timbaland and Swizz Beatz, riding the wave of increased virtual concert broadcasts. Gladys Knight announced the Verzuz battle through a video package filmed in a kitchen at her estate while singing an a cappella rendition of Midnight Train to Georgia. Knight is known as the soul singing restaurateur, formerly of Gladys Knight and Ron Wynan's Chicken and Waffles, a franchise concept that continues the tradition of the beautician, cook, and musician Mahalia Jackson's fried chicken and gas station chains during Jim Crow, an era of racial apartheid for the majority of the 20th century, or into the majority of the 20th century. Knight was a spokeswoman for Light Aunt Jemima Maple Syrup as well. Let's actually take a listen to her jingle.
Do you ever think you'd find a light syrup that tasted better than a regular? Well, you can just stop looking, cuz with Aunt Jemima, now you're cooking. Not only does Aunt Jemima.
Aunt Jemima, a popular icon that originated from musical mammy stereotypes, that is being revisited in rebranding efforts today. Aunt Jemima is a mammy figure thought to be an illiterate singing cook who prepared food according to instinct alone. Chicken and waffles were popularized among musicians in Harlem, and Knight transplanted the combo, benefiting from the 1996 Olympics in Atlanta's economic boom with the opening of her restaurant that focused on chicken and waffles. And here's a few more images for the musicologists in the room, reminding us of the musical legacy of Aunt Jemima. She is also a curious choice for a spokesman for diabetes awareness. Her co-founder, Ron Wynan, succumbed to the disease. Knight hums as she puts the finishing touches on her banana pudding in the package for that versus battle, a beloved African-American dessert. In that package, she threw down the gauntlet, signifying her aptitude as a cook and hit maker on command. She sings for us a cappella.
L.A. proved too much for the man. Said he's going back to find a simpler place and time. I'm going with him, though. And I'll be with him on that midnight train to Georgia. Woo! Two times. Woo-hoo! I've got to go. I better hurry up and make this stuff, or he'll be gone. I'd rather live in his world than live without him in mine. That's why I cook so good. Hey, Patty, bet you can't do it like this.
So that is Ms. Knight cooking food that makes you want to sing. Ms. Patty cooks for various celebrities, writes cookbooks, and hosts cooking shows. Her dessert line skyrocketed when a vlogging influencer, James Wright Chanel, posted a widely distributed review video in 2015 about her LaBelle-inspired mass-produced sweet potato pie. A riveting venture because LaBelle, like Knight, manages her diabetes. James Wright Chanel, a caterer and singer in his own right, began to sing snippets of her songs, If Only You Knew, When You've Been Blessed, Lady Marmalade, a fortuitous culinary allusion, and a few other songs from LaBelle's catalog as his musical testament to the pie's taste, moisture, and beauty. Declaring that viewers should support black businesses, Chanel backed up as he flaps his arms up and down in an iconic LaBelle choreography. And I'll play a snippet and offer that there is strong language.
Greetings. So I went to the store after I seen somebody post that Patti LaBelle pie. I love Patti LaBelle. Shout out to Patti LaBelle, honey. I went and bought the Patti LaBelle pie. Sweet potato Patti LaBelle. This is the Patti edition, honey. This is the on my own. Why did it end this way? So, Katrina, I bought you a pie. You get this video, see this video. You said buy you a pie, bitch. I bought you a pie. Bitch, I bought five pies. I'm gonna do a raffle. Anybody wanna win a pie? So I'm about to slice this pie. I think that this pie, cause Patti LaBelle could cook. So I'm just thinking that buying this pie, it's hard to get in this motherfucker. Patti, what you sell this bitch with? Gorilla glue? The shade of getting into the bitch. Okay. So, oh, wait a minute. Oh, there we go. Come on, Patti, you better come out. Come on, Patti! I opened Patti up. Remember, support black people, black businesses. Okay, so look. Oh, it's so pretty. Look at that. On my own. Why did it end this way? Come on, Patti. So let's taste the Patti. I want to taste Patti. Oh, Patty's so moist. Come on, Patti! Patti! I want to taste Patti live and make a video for those that said what it tastes like. I ain't never tasted it, so here we go. Patti. If anybody know Patti LaBelle, tag her in the video. Patti! Whoa! Bitch, I turned into Patty. You turned into Patty after eating this.
Although Chanel's ringing endorsement, which goes on from here, of her pie has been attributed to the momentum she got in early sales, even LaBelle was slow to give him credit for his impact. That is the lens, though, his perspective is the lens, though, through which fans view her video announcement where she musically enters through a recording, unlike Knight's a cappella version. We find her dressed in an all-white dolman sleeve top, literally stirring the pot in her kitchen.
Hi, Gladys. I've done all this. So what are you bringing? Sunday night at 8 p.m. versus.
If I had the time, I would talk about the shadiness of her, of her using a recording and not using a cappella in terms of hit makers and what all of that suggests, friendly banter, if you will. But all of these are performances of food that makes us want to sing. Beginning their career during Jim Crow, again, an era of racial apartheid in the U.S., when black touring musicians were unable to purchase homes or eat where they pleased. Miss Patti LaBelle and Gladys Knight performed Being High on the Hog, that is, being well off, living comfortably or extravagantly due to great wealth or financial security. However, their ascent is not without a struggle. Many touring musicians dined at family members' homes or restaurants listed in the Green Book, for example, avoiding the dangers of Jim Crow when possible. Frederick Douglass Opie, quoting Driscoll, noted, quote, "You could not eat out at just any place because of Jim Crow laws, so restaurants that catered to coloreds flourished during segregation that restricted the public dining options for African Americans." The string of restaurants, theaters, and clubs were referred to as the Chitlin' Circuit, serving as concert venues that propelled many musicians' careers. People of African ancestry have always possessed tangible and intangible wealth, from gold or oil to intellectual property that has been consumed and exploited in the global marketplace. Across black music genres, artists have linked their musical and gustatory prowess to transport their fan base on a multi-sensory journey. As such, these touring tastemakers dwell in what culinary writer Tony Tipton Martin calls the Jemima Code, legacy of cooking by instinct, embodying culinary wisdom and cultural authority, so much so that they were stereotyped to be musical sounding bodies, as evidenced by the lullabies we saw earlier that inspired and the products generated from the troubling Aunt Jemima stereotype. For instance, shortly after the term soul food was popularized on the heels of the soul music genre, culinary anthropologist and Sun Ra touring musician Verdeme Smart Grosvenor published the cookbook memoir Vibration Cooking, or The Travel Notes of a Geechee Girl, and Thursdays and Every Other Sunday, Sunday Off, a domestic rap by Verdeme. In the tradition of Zora Neale Hurston's ethnographic research and Edna Lewis's culinary preservation, Vibration Cooking also challenged the primacy of the soul food concept by centering on food as a source of pride, a site of sensuality, an art of multisensory storytelling, a validation of black womanhood, and black consciousness raising. Smart Grosvenor was an experienced and trained cook who wrote, quote, "When I cook, I never measure or weigh anything. I cook by vibration," end quote. A value shared by Knight and LaBelle. She penned an intersection of music, sound, sensuality, culinary perception that has yet to be explored through the lens of music or sound studies. Probing that constellation of soulful, musical, sensual, and culinary perception, the manual I'm writing, Ultrasonic Tastemakers, A Critical Gastromusicology, is a groundbreaking critical gastromusicological investigation into the interconnectedness of African-American embodiment, oral transmission, cultural production, wealth extraction, and consumption in the global marketplace, as emblematic of what I coin as gastromusicophysics, or multisensory taste. Consumption is a multisensory activity in which auditory and gustatory appetites are conjoined and manipulated in the marketplace. This critical gastromusicology swells the critical eating research of Kyla Wazana Tompkins and others that implicitly entails, quote, the examination of the field of food studies on conscious investments in the commodity itself, end quote. And here, the commodity is the musical and sounding body. Moving from touring musicians like Knight and LaBelle, their entertainment factor, and prompted by the high demand and distribution of African-American music and foodways as major U.S. industries and exports, this book project takes seriously accounts of the pain and pleasure in gastromusicological flows throughout U.S. history, from work songs sung while harvesting plantations or advertising produce as fruit vendors to performing strange fruit in jazz clubs during segregation. While previous gastromusicological research has focused on composers' culinary lives and music researchers' foodways, encounters, and recipes, there's not been an in-depth multisensory exploration of African-American tastemakers' musico-gustatory role in satiating consumers' voracious appetites for African-derived culture on the world stage. The case studies in the book provide a multifaceted structure for African-American gastromusicology through musicians' use of food metaphor in songs, the pursuit of culinary arts in restaurateurship, recipe and food writing, multisensory ritual practice, and music and food tourism. To amplify the precarity of the abundance we heard and saw in Knight and LaBelle's homes, I juxtapose their performance of being high on the hog with being in an age of in-home police killings of first responder Breonna Taylor, who was sleeping with her beloved, Botham John, who was eating ice cream in his living room, and my friend, composer Herman Whitfield III, who was killed in a wellness check, among many others. In this talk, I provide a degustation, a tasting of Aunt Jemima Code to establish the crucial contributions of tastemakers at the intersection of musical gustatory and sonogustatory production. In monetized mobility through the areas of critical gastromusicology analysis. In this presentation, I look at multisensory curation as tastemakers, the nanny figure and Black women as energy sources, and semiotics or unsavory seasoning practices in our historical concept. To do this, I consider taste-making culture bearers' contributions and challenge the notion of African Americans as a bottom consumer class, as I read their overrepresentation in the marketplace as a consumed class. I review people of African ancestry's modes of gendered oral transmission of recipes intermingled with their everyday musical moments and the exploitative publishing of those recipes that are revealed in the critical food studies archives, Additionally, these silenced testimonials provide a broader view of what constitutes soundscapes and shapes genres in plantation economies. Masculinized Black women's bodies were a fundamentally overlooked and muted loci of gastromusical physics transmission. I conclude by looking at the multivalent nature of the concept of seasoning and the extent to which those very African bodies are the litmus, the secret ingredient, if you will, through which we certify the soundness of the body politic's consumption of African humans' tangible and intangible assets. Before we continue, I propose a structure of anti-oppressive listening that includes paying attention to how we consider marginalized community, sitting in a posture that is willing to question all that we thought or assumed to be true. If you are not at the table, you are on the menu. We have heard it said variously, if you are not at the table, you are on the menu. African-American bodily positionality as a consumed class has been made apparent through the wild reception of the 2022 film reviewing Jeffrey Dahmer's aberrant appetite as a serial killer of Black men and boys. Monster's reception points to a homoerotic legacy of cannibalism and necrophilia that we would rather overlook in the popular imagination by people who, like Dahmer, are found to be legally sane. Shortly after Dahmer's capture, the front cover of People magazine, published on August 12, 1991, read, quote, "Horror in Milwaukee. He was a quiet man who worked in a chocolate factory, but at home in apartment 213, a real-life Silence of the Lambs was unfolding." Now that Jeffrey Dahmer has confessed to 17 grotesque murders, his troubling history of alcoholism, sex offenses, and bizarre behavior raises a haunting question. Why wasn't he stopped? Why wasn't he stopped? Shared libidinal appetites were so stirred in the popular imagination that a mother of three children confessed to Australian radio hosts that she masturbated in response to the ultra-violent Dahmer story about killing Black men and boys. The Dahmer series is reclaiming the horror realm that has been dominated and trial-ran by its fictional derivative, the whitewashed supervillain, virtuosic cook, Hannibal Lecter, a franchise that has been grooming us to make the real story palatable for over 30 years. The franchise overlaid and blurred the luxurious display of the culinary arts atop the grotesque hunger for flesh. However, this taste for bodies is not unique or new. Cannibalism of Black bodies and consumption of those humans' cultural production has been done openly and ferociously for over 500 years. And yet, we have innumerable unsolved cases for maimed Black women and girls. For example, a significant symbol of Western desire is the kidnappee Sarah Bartman, AKA Venus Hottentot, who was said to be a talented vocalist. Once forced to be a human circus attraction among European colonizers, botanist and zoologist Georges Cuvier dissected Bartman's body, plaster casted her buttocks, and pickled her genitals in a jar that was stored in the Musée d'Homme in Paris. And ironically, Black women and women in general, their reproductive area at that time was referred to as the apron or the tablier. Libidinal logic of American racism, writes Kyla Tompkins in Racial Indigestion, quote, leads to an extreme image of the Black body itself as food, end quote. Fast forward to more recent times in Sweden, when yet again, women's reproduction is crafted into a site for deep investigation. And ironically, Bartman's likeness replicated as a chocolate confection to be eaten as protest for female circumcision or genital mutilation in Africa. People called for the Swedish culture minister to resign after she cut into artist Makode Lind's piece, Painful Cake, during a World Art Day event at the Stockholm Modern Art Museum. The Painful Cake piece was shaped and decorated as a naked, indigenous-looking African woman. Its black Swedish male artist placed his head with blackface-style makeup as a head of the cake woman's body and can be heard screaming, ventriloquizing African women's torment as the installation attendees cut into the body. This masculinized black woman's sound is ripe for critical gastromusicological investigation. The artist Lind was eventually arrested, charged with and acquitted of animal cruelty, interests that align actually with the black male flesh-eating Dahmer. These indignities persist. If it were not for black women's service to medicine through gynecology and genetic information from involuntarily mined unquieted genes from that of Henrietta Lacks, non-African women would not enjoy advances in women's health. When news of this debacle broke, I recall the trauma I experienced in observing how its coverage was handled in interracial feminist music scholar settings. The reverberations of amusement, voyeurism, desensitization, and body snatching potential was astounding, particularly the slippages across boundaries of familiarity and consumption in the doing of advocacy. I learned that intercultural, interracial feminism falters when regarding the divine feminine African on the global marketplace. Viewing the painful cake consumption was buck-breaking anew. First, I would like to examine the Aunt Jemima stereotype of black women as merely natural home cooks without any intention, artistry, or curation ascribed to them. Tastemaking was a major colonial import, dating beyond the era of taste in the Western world in the 17th and 18th century. For example, historian of Senegambian tastemakers, Jessica Marie Johnson, asserts that in the transatlantic slave trade, Senegambian women used kinship and intimacy to fashion and acquire freedom. Their intimacy spanned the spectrum of coerced to strategic, from fraternal to sexual, end quote. In an account of a wealthy woman trader named Kati, she unhesitatingly instructed a European tradesperson on how to dine in the Senegambian culture, as though she was accustomed to teaching them good taste in appealing and pleasurable spaces. At St. Louis and Gorée, women traders and their workers catered to the tradesmen through feasts and dances with griots and drumming in the soundscape at major celebrations. Public dances called folgars were the places where women displayed their hospitality. Path-breaking black male cooks were the early arbiters of nourishment. During an era that a ravenous appetite manifested for multisensory thievery and exploitation of African intellectual properties through white eavesdropping on African oral transmission, notably among those black male cooks was Hercules Posey, who was the cook for President George Washington. His impact was so significant that numerous scholars have widely assumed that he was the brains and hands behind the recipes that Mrs. Martha Washington published in her cookbook. And then there was James Hemings, the sibling of Sally Hemings, the enslaved woman with whom President Thomas Jefferson sired children. Formerly trained in French cooking techniques, James Hemings interpreted a now staple dishes in American cuisine, such as ice cream and macaroni and cheese. Black tastemakers' ideas were prompted, engaged, developed, mined, harvested, and processed through their masters and mistresses' transcription of their conversations in colonial life. As explained in an interview with the great Southern culinary culture bearer, Ms. Edna Lewis, who famously liked to be called Ms. Lewis, she begins by describing the early development of foodways in the United States that stems from colonial entitlement to tasteful black labor in the kitchen and farmland. In that era, it was illegal for enslaved Africans to read, write, and copyright their musical intellectual property or plantation-based gastronomic inventiveness as well. Enslaved Africans were the technology by which recipes were transmitted, while placing their signature on time-honored Americana dishes without any credit. Ms. Lewis recounting illumines invaluable black male hidden figures, human computer tastemakers who learn international cooking techniques orally from various credentialed chefs, thus making the primacy of the kitchen space masculine in our historical memory. From planting, to harvesting, to hunting, to butchering, to cooking, to distilling liquor, to roasting game, to serving, black men were involved in the entire food preparation process in a plantation hierarchy that did not ensure that they were properly nourished themselves. We know that enslaved people's sustenance and indulgence was so surveilled that enslavers wrote of accounts of what was called the whistling walk. And many of you may have heard about the whistling walk, according to Chef Kevin Mitchell, thanks to social media. Chef Kevin Mitchell is a Southern cuisine culture bearer who researched the enslaved narratives of Charleston, South Carolina.
For more than a decade, Chef Kevin Mitchell has been studying the stories of enslaved chefs and cooks.
My research for my master's thesis talks about enslaved cooks from Charleston.
The chief instructor at the Culinary Institute of Charleston stirs emotions as he adds ingredients to this one-pot dish. Listen as he explains what enslaved people did to prove they were not eating their master's food.
So there's stories of this thing called the whistling walk, where enslaved would come from a main kitchen and they would be carrying food in their hand. And as they're carrying this food in their hand, they have to whistle. The whistling in the eyes of the slaveholder means that because you're whistling, you don't have the time or you can't eat my food. I had always been interested in like the history of African Americans and cooking and what they cook.
What were some of the dishes they brought here that might be familiar to us?
Hoppin' John,
Whistling walk describes both the literal pathway and the action of servants while whistling, while carrying the food that they prepared in the kitchen toward the dining room for service. Their uninterrupted sounding was to ensure that they did not taste, eat, or tamper with their owners' and guests' food. As long as they were whistling, they were not eating. They were to remain hungry while preparing and serving. Literally redefining our hearing of the nostalgic sentiments of whistle while you work, making the sound of whistling during dining service a facet of the colonial work song genre, I argue. Early security system sounds as well. And thus, it served as a early alarm system for those who were in plantation life. Diffusing white enslavers' anxieties through this musical practice of whistling to transport food in this instance set a genealogical precedent for a racialization of the whistle, a historical pattern of entertainment derived from our sounded hunger. Listeners have merely reasoned that the sounds of whistling and singing were heard as the sounds of pleasure as they worked and not surveillance. This sonic socialization transferred over time the same use of the whistling as signaling that black men are jovial, content, or non-threatening, soothing even in play and everyday life. As with most narratives of cruel, torturous, and traumatic behavior during chattel slavery, this practice has been contested. The mortifying details like being made to eat from troughs like animals or the origins of U.S. tipping practices as an extension of European master-serf arrangements have been altogether avoided. However, there are several instances in orature, visual iconography, and subsequent period reenactments that refute the illegitimacy of these claims, evidenced by remnant social anxieties, for instance. In addition, there are diasporic beliefs that whistling is evil, diabolic, and that it heightens the extent to which being made to whistle was torture for the whistler. These anxieties and superstitions persist so much, many descendants of Southern African Americans are not permitted to whistle in their homes to this day. In the next section, I'd like to explore the tensions found in the Aunt Jemima stereotype as a nanny. And I do have some whistling repertoire with some problematic titles, such as Whistling Coon. Some of us may recall Whistle While You Work, popularized by Disney. Reading the lyrics in light of this sort of legacy can be a little bit troubling when we think of this. And then, of course, famously in popular music, we have Whistle While You Twerk, another reinterpretation for our nightclubbing joy. The next section, bioacoustic transmission of genetic information. We are a strange, bountiful harvest. One Sunday, some years ago, I was invited to an Episcopal church to preach about racism, prompted by my ethnomusicology colleague and friend, Ruth Stone's invitation. Afterward, an elderly Southern white woman approached me at the door as I greeted the parishioners. She reached for my hand, leaned in, and whispered to me that she was super close with her black nanny. Perhaps she was like sharecropper Fannie Lou Hamer's enslaved grandmother when she sang to her.
Passed down from my grandmother. My grandmother was a slave, and it was a little song that my grandmother would sing to her children, and my mother would sing it to us. Then when my little children come along, I would always sing, sheep high, where your little lamb? Way down in the valley, birds and the butterflies picking at his eye, and the poor little thing, he cried, mama, mama's gone, papa's gone. They shall bring some horses, white and black, speckled and gray, all them pretty little horses.
This collection of recordings is so beautiful, so haunting, and it further unlays the impact of who she was as a mobilizer. I encourage you to check out this recording. But this is the sort of repertoire that would have been sung to this woman's to this woman by her nanny. The woman recalled nursing at her nanny's breast. Her nanny sang lullabies to her, cooked for her, and looked after her. She was family, the woman thought. She was also a wet nurse, a lactating black woman whose service role was to breastfeed other people's children. It was not until she was an adult and attended her nanny's funeral that she learned her last name and that she even had children of her own. She repented and told me she had a lot to think about. She was questioning all that was true to her, or rather the extent to which so much had been misrepresented to her. Her Miss Sarah, or Mrs. Sarah, was a mammy figure in a line of women who embody the human biological intersection of gastromusicology, in which enslavers and their descendants consumed the maternal bioacoustics, skin-to-skin sensory nurture, and biological matter The mitochondrial information transmitted through consuming the milk emitted through breastfeeding. The interracial and transcaste practice of breastfeeding, the energy exertion through lactation, adds another level of epigenetic and sociocultural sensory memory for Black women in relation to the dominant cultural population, that of superficial, multisensory soothing, cradled in Black women's arms like musical womb chairs through intelligent sound and touch modalities that simultaneously intercept the biological and acoustic information anatomically created for Black women's children, thus causing maternal separation for the African child. Additionally, one must cogitate the extended exertion that enslaved and likely malnourished Black women underwent to serve as forced laborers who jeopardized their own wellness. According to lactation exertion research, undernourished women and those who did not gain adequate body weight during pregnancy must conserve as much energy as possible for their own well-being and that of their infants. Hence, in these women, the full energy demands of lactation must be provided by an increment in dietary intake. To be an enslaved Black woman was to be an energy source, to incubate the enslaver's young, surrendering one's required human energy to function daily and to be present for the big house and their family. Moreover, through epigenetics, we now know that maternal separation stresses the baby and causes gene expressions echoing for 3+ generations. The expressed behaviors appear to be depression, anxiety, and reactivity to stress in adulthood. Lulling a suckling white Euro-American baby, the offspring of the colonizer, to sleep is the instance in which Black women's bodies become the embodied loci of gastromusicology in the global marketplace. Their bodies used as the site for developing and transferring multisensory taste to the white Euro-American child. Whether through wet nursing or harvesting of genetic material without consent, the legacies are harrowing epitome of biological wealth extraction. Breastfeeding and musically soothing as one nurses embodies the lengths of the consumption in the marketplace in which they were the site for a bind of affective and sensuous bonding, soothing, and torture that has been referred to as seasoning. And this is the last portion I have for you. The mammy figure embodied in the Aunt Jemima stereotype was a nourishing musical figure who was vulnerable in the US race-based caste system. Like the culinary connotation of wet nursing, the U.S. colonial practice of seasoning the enslaved was another instance in which we are confronted with a torturous juncture of sound, music, and culinary arts in our history. Seasoning was a process of breaking the spirits of individuals who were to be enslaved through physical, verbal, and spiritual dismemberment. In the book, The Delectable Negro by Vincent Woodard, it confirms that African bodies were consumed through cannibalism. Quote, in addition to literal acts of eating, carving, and cooking flesh, European and American whites developed a culture of cannibalism wherein daily acts of violence, religious conversion, slave seasoning and breaking, and sexual brutality all fed into the master's appetite for African flesh and souls. Many historical texts on the subject of slavery describe the importance of the process of seasoning for breaking men and women and making them into docile slaves. Elaborating on the culinary connotations of the word seasoning, season to heighten or improve the flavor of food by adding condiments, spices, herbs, or the like, linking the physically brutal culture of seasoning to the parallel development of erotic appetites, tastes, and aesthetic longings for the Black male, end quote. Laws even specified the ways in which body parts were amputated, as forms of punishment for enslaved people. For example, ear cropping, cutting of hamstrings, amputation, and shoulder branding, to name some specifications. In historian Stephanie E. Jones Rogers' They Were Her Property, I encountered an account of torture set in motion by a mistress in the making that was to have been in my paternal home region of the Carolinas. Quote, Lizzie Anna Burwell was like many other white girls growing up in the slaveholding households in the Lenzville, North Carolina area in 1847. She loved flowers and often strolled through her parents' garden with Fanny, the enslaved woman charged with her care. After spending so much time with Fanny, Lizzie Anna developed an intense bond with her, but one day, Lizzie Anna became vexed with Fanny. So she went to her father and demanded that he cut Fanny's ear off and get her, Lizzie Anna, a new maid from Clarksville. Lizzie was 3 years old. She was coming to understand the obscene logic that made it perfectly acceptable to enjoy the company of her enslaved caretaker in one moment and threaten to mutilate her or buy another slave to take her place in the next, end quote. Here is proof of an auditory related seasoning, threat to an enslaved woman that has profound musicological disabilities, trauma, and sound studies implications. Her request was not far-fetched. It was consistent with Dahmer's practices and the torture that befell Bartman. Ear cropping was one practice in a repertoire of human branding done to the enslaved to prove purchase. And I typically have a video for extended presentations of the extent to which ear cropping was carried out. Ear cropping was a punishment prescribed by law in several states, perhaps a custom stemming from biblical literalism. In New Orleans and Pennsylvania historical records, we find that convicts' ears were cut off. Cutting the rim of the ear was a means of making the rightless, plainly treating humans like livestock. Additionally, ear cropping had sonic disability implications for the outer ear, which helps humans assess sound localization. Such impairment could mean sonically induced frustration in social settings, trauma, disorientation, imprecision in everyday tasks, and dis-ease in private interactions, as accounted for when an enslaved woman navigated an envious mistress who whispered in her ear while she slept. Lastly, one should note that given the numerous enslaved Africans who were followers of Islam, it was fortuitous that ear cropping would affect the experience and optics of the Salat and the prayerful ritual gesture of ear cupping that dates back to the 7th and 8th century as a method of religious subjugation, adding insult to injury. Sonic orientation and positioning in prayer are essential to the multisensory practice, sensing the direction and position of the body, equilibrium supported by the inner ear, and sound localization, as well as auto and bio acoustic intensity through covering the ear. Ear cropping and other torture methods left an indelible mark that was read by enslavers in the marketplace as indicators of past and future defiance, thereby influencing the enslaved person's worth and enslaver's wealth. According to historian Charlotte M. Fett in Working Cures, worth was appraised through the notion of soundness, in which an enslaved person's overall state of health, and by extension his or her worth in the marketplace, extended to mental and moral dimensions of slave health and character. Enslaved people's health was determined by their capacity to labor, reproduce, obey, and submit. Moreover, the repercussions of falling short of all these traits cohere in the ear cropping of Black women's wet nursing bodies. This assessment was conveyed through the Certificate of Soundness that was intended to protect buyers' purchases and sellers' liabilities. Even slave life insurance relied on measurements of slave soundness. In conclusion, U.S. musical and culinary taste-making roots stem from the exploited labor and stolen intellectual property of African songs, formulas, and recipes. To ensure that the enslaved Africans were never liberated or retrieved their property, they were seasoned, forcefully bred, lactated, and threatened with the inability to be certified with soundness. Despite the interception of Black mothers bonding with their children, these women have somehow found ways, in the case of Fannie Lou Hamer's grandmother, to connect with their children using the oral transmission of music. Unfortunately, the generations of malnutrition and exertion have contributed to genetic and diet-related health issues, such as heart disease and type 2 diabetes. It was in those kitchens and gardens that they worked, downloaded information, and fashioned a way to start their own ventures using their medicinal, cosmetic, scientific, and culinary discoveries. However, when African Americans have been able to, they have chosen to avoid the wrong food, to express spiritual discipline, physical endurance, and myriad forms of unseen nourishment. And now, popular women musicians like Knight, LaBelle, have embraced their exposure to the importance of comfort foods, exerting and satiating themselves while touring on the road. They realize the market for providing multi-sensory experience to cultural tourists seeking to eat food that makes them hum, groan, dance, food that makes them want to sing with abandon. Thank you. Shall I take questions or comments? Do I have time? I know we started. Okay, awesome. Thank you guys for coming and being attentive listeners. If there are any comments or questions or thoughts in progress, I invite you to share. And it's hard for me to see, maybe it's my glasses, so feel free. Okay, great. For a little bit of time, yes. I'm wrapping up the manuscript, but yes, it will be available for a little bit of time. Thank you. Any other thoughts, comments, or questions? Sure. I hear that as a question about sort of where this is in my research agenda. Is that? My initial book project was on Black men's performance of gender and sexuality in gospel music, where discourses of cannibalism and homoeroticism emerged a lot. Issues of torture and the erotics of that emerged a lot. So I'm following up on that and thinking about Black women's existence, how they are taken for granted. And through this, we can see the thievery of intellectual property in many different ways. I resonate with the previous lecture in the sense that intellectual property in many ways will save us, these intangible assets, understanding how we were left out of patents, copyrights, registering of trademarks, and how we have contributed involuntarily to the wealth of nations. So this is my way of contributing to the urgency of the discourse. I think in the long run, though, my project is to look at African American music research through a prism of query. So I may have started in Black sacred music and gender and sexuality, but I do desire to keep turning that prism and looking at the intersections with everyday life, definitely with an attention toward the social justice and direct action that can be had in such research. Thank you. So my next project is Anti-Oppressive Listening to Black Women, a book entitled Sounding Our Signatures, a Womanist Music Research Approach. And I'm wrapping that up too.
Can we thank Dr. Lee?
All right, we've got about 10 minutes before our next lecture. I would encourage you, if you are here, to please check out Classical Vocal Reprints. They have a booth set up just outside in the north lobby, and we will start with our third and final lecture of the day in just a few moments.